Hello and welcome to the Business Standard Morning Show. I'm Ishan Gera and here are the stories for the day. Just as we thought that we were out of the woods, the threat of a new COVID-19 variant, Omicron, has started looming large over the global economy, which is still in doldrums. Not just the vulnerabilities of economies, the pandemic has also laid bare the vaccine inequality between the rich and the poor nations. While the developed nations are rushing to give booster shots, the poor countries are grappling to vaccinate their population. Let's take a look at this and other factors that have contributed to the current crisis.
The vaccine inequality between the rich and poor nations is as stark as the economic disparity between them. While some countries are rushing to give booster shots to its people in the face of the new COVID-19 variant, others have not been able to fully vaccinate even 10% of their population. They do not have stock at all. South African countries, from where the new variant is said to have emerged, have very low vaccination rates. Overall, just 6% of the population in Africa has been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. Now, more than 30 countries have banned travel from Southern Africa. Rich countries continue to hoard vaccines when redistributing them to lower and middle-income countries is the need of the hour. High-income countries have administered 120 doses per 100 people compared to just 3 doses per 100 people for low-income countries. Eminent epidemiologist Dr. Jayaprakash Mulyal spoke with us on the importance of vaccine equity.
Equity is an important issue to globally reduce mortality due to COVID-19 and consequently bring down the perceived public health importance of the disease. COVID-19 should eventually become an infection of no serious consequences. It's not easy to link emergence of new strains with vaccine equity or absence of vaccine equity. Immunodeficiency due to other reasons like HIV may facilitate these emergences.
Even as wealthy countries rush to expand booster campaigns, others are not even able to vaccinate their most at-risk people. The World Health Organization has now warned against giving COVID-19 booster shots to healthy adults, saying that hard-won gains could vanish in an instant. By the end of October, wealthy countries had donated only 10% of the 1.3 billion doses they had pledged to global vaccine sharing program COVAX. COVAX aimed to secure vaccines for about 100 low and middle income economies at the same time as wealthier nations. It has so far shipped 580 million doses against its downwardly revised target of 1.425 billion doses by the end of 2021. The reduced supply to COVAX came at the cost of rich countries hoarding vaccines. Doctors Without Borders estimates that 10 high-income countries, including the US, UK, Germany, and France, would be holding 870 million excess doses by the end of this year, even after boosters have been administered for high-risk groups. 241 million vaccine doses held by just the European Union and G7 countries could expire if they are not used by the end of 2021. At the same time, rich nations have also consistently opposed patent waiver on COVID-19 vaccines. The idea, which was first proposed by India and South Africa a year ago, would have allowed companies in developing countries to freely manufacture cheaper versions of the vaccines. Despite support from over 100 countries, including the US, the waiver of intellectual property related to COVID-19 vaccines is yet to be approved at the World Trade Organization. While experts might not strictly link the lack of vaccine equity alone with the emergence of new variants, it cannot be denied that if indeed Omicron originated in Southern Africa, then greater vaccine coverage in that region could have reduced the chances of such a thing happening.
Last year, November, December, the vaccines were rolled out outside in India. We started it in January of this year. It's unfortunate that a lot of the developing countries have not got the requisite vaccines that were promised. And you look across, whether it's Europe, USA, they have immense quantities of vaccines, and even some of them are nearing expiry date. As they say, I'm not safe till my neighbor is also safe. So if my neighbor's house is in fire, my house also will catch fire. So I think so. We need to be very clear. It's a global village now. None of us are safe if our neighbors are not safe. So we should have ramped up the vaccination. I think so. Now, obviously, in hindsight, all of us become wiser. But to be fair to the WHO, the Director General WHO, Dr. Tedros, has been speaking on this on multiple times. Whenever the booster topic came up, it was, for heaven's sake, let us spread the vaccination across the globe, give it to the areas of the place where it is most required, in Africa. And he kept on telling, harping on Africa, and that is what has happened. If you look at this Omicron that has come out, it was detected in Botswana and South Africa. And to be fair to them, they had the foresight, they had the courage to speak up, do the genome sequencing, and tell the world that this is there and let's be careful. Unlike what happened early last year from a neighboring country. So I think so. That's something that's very important, that vaccine equity is something that we let go. We didn't supply to everyone. And the other thing which happened also in India is that because of our second wave, which hit us very brutally, we were just prior to that, we had started our export of vaccines. But when our second wave hit us, we had to stop it. So that also played a significant role, if I can put it. But I don't blame the government of India, because first of all, we have to save ourselves also, because it was very brutal. But I would like to hold the European countries and the USA also accountable on this, because they had surplus. We didn't have surplus.
Vaccination is currently the strongest weapon we have to avoid the emergence of new variants. Experts say that only a significant level of global immunity can limit the spread of new variants, as well as reduce the opportunity for them to emerge in the first place. It is high time that rich countries start diverting doses to the developing world, as inequitable distribution of vaccines will only prolong the pandemic.
The last 2 years have been transformative for the home healthcare industry in India, believes Meena Ganesh, co-founder and chairperson of Portea. In an interview with Business Standard's Krishna Veera Vanamali, she says her focus is on developing a strong tech ecosystem to manage patients with chronic diseases and taking hospital-like services into the home. Let's join the conversation.
Thank you for joining us.
Pleasure to be here, Krishna.
COVID especially, it has been a transforming time for the entire healthcare sector. And again, it has put companies like you in spotlight. So how has it changed Portea Medical? And I'm pretty sure the company must have experienced a boom. And is it still ongoing? And how do you see the future from COVID?
Sure. No, that's a very valid point that you make, Krishna. Last nearly 2 years have been absolutely transformatory for the healthcare industry, and specifically players like us who work in the outside of hospital healthcare. There is a huge role to be played by healthcare outside of the facilities, in people's homes, in communities, through digital. And all of this has come to the center stage thanks to all that happened during the last nearly 18 to 20 months. Now, if you go back to wave one, we reached out to some of the state governments and suggested that not all of the COVID patients, for COVID positive patients, necessarily need care in either a COVID care center or in a hospital. They could very well be stabilized at home, monitored there, and if required, transferred to a facility. And we set up a whole protocol for monitoring patients using a combination of technology, telecom, and medical professionals, remotely monitoring them, talking to them at regular intervals, capturing the data of their vitals, and basis their condition, deciding whether they needed any further care or not. So in this process, about 4 lakh patients were managed by us, monitored and managed by us over the first wave across 6 different state governments. And the demand was not just from patients, but doctors and hospitals, pharma companies, all and insurance companies said, can we take more treatment into the homes? Because clearly it's difficult for patients to come into the hospitals. So we saw that there was a lot more of demand for elder care, for continuous monitoring of senior citizens. And the last one that is relevant in my view is the change in the mindset of insurance companies, of the governments, regulators, etc., who realize that there is it's important to give legitimacy and to provide reimbursement for the home care and outside of hospital care therapies also.
Can you briefly explain what kind of technologies that Protea uses to service its clients?
We have ensured that there is a very strong technology layer that is put in place, making sure that our patients can reach out to us easily. We can assign our clinicians to them. Our clinicians have an app through which they know where they have to go, which patient to attend, and all the data and all the activities that they have to do around the patients are all built around that. So any patient that gets onboarded and who we believe needs long-term treatment, which is 80% plus of our patients, we open a treatment plan for them and we keep tracking. And that in that, we put down protocols. How often do we need to speak to them? What data should be collected? If something, some of their medical vitals are off, what action should be taken? So that whole protocol for each type of patient is made available. So any patient who's onboarded on that, we are able to manage their treatment very effectively over long periods of time.
You know, home healthcare is still considered to be at a very nascent stage in India. And among all of your segments, where do you think the most demand will come from in the future?
There are two, three areas where I see significant growth. Okay, one is in managing patients with chronic diseases. And this cuts across both elders who are, like I said, who need long-term care, as well as it could be even middle-aged people who need care for their chronic diseases over long periods of time. The second area which is seeing a lot of growth is, as I mentioned earlier, bringing a lot of hospital-like services into the home, which is more complex diseases are being managed at home.
Do you mind sharing any numbers related to Protea, revenue growth or funding or just the sales numbers, anything?
I would say that about 20 to 25% growth per annum is in revenues is what we are seeing right now for this year. And the next year, given that we will start on a much more stronger wicket with big tailwinds that we are seeing, the next year, FY23, we see 30 to 45% growth rates in our own business. We are on a month-on-month basis, we are break-even, and we expect to be fully profitable in the coming financial year.
You've invested in a myriad of startups, especially through Growth Story. And these are all completely unrelated startups. You do not concentrate on a particular sector or anything. So what is your broad investment philosophy?
From 2010, we've been creating a number of startups in areas where we saw that there's a lot of opportunity in the country. So if we looked at, for instance, Big Basket, we felt that grocery delivery at home is a big problem that needs solving in this country. And there is an opportunity to build a very valuable and well-run business in this. So that was the genesis of Big Basket. And then, of course, Protea looking at the healthcare opportunity in India, and Home Lane, which is into household interiors. Basically, what we saw is that where are the big problems in this country? How do we use a combination of our capability, technology skill sets, our understanding of consumer to build a scaled and valuable business in each of these places?
Thank you. Thank you so much, Meena. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Krishna.
We can now avail hospital-like healthcare and personalized services right at our homes. And COVID concerns are not over. Market participants are reading into the developments surrounding the Omicron variant of COVID-19. Not surprisingly, pharma stocks have caught investor fancy. Meanwhile, US Fed Chair Jerome Powell has said it's time to stop using the word transitory to describe inflation. This could possibly mean more pain in the store for consumption-related companies. Against these contrasting outlooks, let's find out if investing in these sectors will prove to be beneficial for investors amid the current volatility.
Frequent bounce backs and corrections are keeping investors confused about the market trajectory. As COVID-19 cases continue to spike across the globe and vaccine efficacy unknown against the new variant, adopting a prudent investment strategy is the way forward to safeguard one's portfolio. An analysis by ICICI Direct shows that all major market corrections since April 2020 got arrested within 9 to 11% range. And buying in each of these corrections has been fruitful for investors as indices subsequently retested previous highs. Given this, research analysts at ICICI Direct expect markets to maintain the same rhythm this time around too. In the current scenario, after a 31% rally in the past 6 months, the benchmarks have corrected 9% from their respective lifetime highs. Therefore, the ongoing correction should be capitalized on as an incremental buying opportunity to ride the structural uptrend. But will putting your money behind the classic defensive bets prove to be beneficial this time? Let us find out. Over the past few months, healthcare stocks have witnessed retracement while IT stocks have been consolidating in a narrow range. As these stocks form fresh base at higher levels, analysts foresee decent returns from the space in the days ahead. Select pharma stocks, for instance, can rally up to 15% on the bourses as discussion around expediting vaccination drive and booster shots to the vulnerable population gains currency. As per tech charts, shares of Alembic Pharma and Cipla are eyeing 15% and 13% upside respectively, as both these counters are trading firmly above their support zones. Those of Glenmark and Torrent Pharma, meanwhile, may gain between 11 and 15%. That said, the overall industry's outlook is not very optimistic, as growth is likely to slow and export growth could fall to low single digits. Moreover, there are cost and supply challenges due to the energy crisis in China. The other defensive sector, FMCG, can also be on investor radar, though it is expected to continue with its underperformance. So far in the financial year 2021-22, with the S&P BSE FMCG index has risen 6.3% as compared to over 15% gain in the benchmark S&P BSE Sensex during this period. The underperformance was mostly on account of concerns of a slowdown in the overall consumption as a result of rising input costs in an inflationary environment. And data backs this too. The latest survey by Nielsen IQ shows that India's FMCG market grew 12.6% in the September 2021 quarter compared to the same period last year. However, rural markets witnessed a slowdown due to a dip in consumption, with value growth coming in at 9.4%. Volumes in the rural market contracted 2.9% due to lower consumption of items like cooking oil and packaged grocery. However, as an investment strategy, analysts are bullish on companies like ITC, Nestle, HUL Colgate, and Britannia. Moreover, easing input cost pressures amid drop in crude oil prices will aid the performance of companies, says A.K. Prabhakar, head of research at IDBI Capital. He says the fall in the market from its recent high has further corrected the valuation in a number of these countries. Thus, a blanket investment in defensive plays should be avoided. Analysts suggest focus should be on companies with strong balance sheets and with those having a favorable risk-reward setup. On Thursday, weekly F&O expiry, monthly auto sales data, and global cues will dictate the secondary market trend. The primary market, meanwhile, will be dominated by three public offers. Tega Industries' initial share sale will enter its second day today, with Star Health and Allied Insurance IPO will close later in the day. Additionally, Anand Rathi Wealth will launch its initial public offering today. The price band for the offer has been fixed at Rs. 530 to 550 per share, and the company aims to mobilize 660 crore rupees.
In a volatile market, it's best to pick stocks that enjoy strong balance sheets and favorable risk-reward setup. The lockdown had slowed down our overall consumption in the recent past, but there's apparently no dip in consumption of meat. In fact, we are eating more meat than ever. The amount that per person consumes has tripled in the last 50 years. But people across the world are also becoming more conscious of its negative impact on the environment. Several companies and local eateries have come up with plant-based substitutes which they claim are ethical and as relishing as the non-vegetarian dishes. So let's understand what plant-based meat is and will it be able to lure meat eaters towards a greener future?
At least 50 billion chickens are killed for food across the world every year. The number of larger livestock that are taken to slaughterhouses is equally astonishing. And it is almost impossible to count the creatures which are pulled out of seas and rivers. It also has an environmental cost. According to an estimate by the UN, meat and dairy account for 14.5% of all man-made greenhouse gas emissions. This is greater than the emissions of the entire transport sector. Middle-income countries led by China and India are the biggest consumers of meat, but its demand in Europe and in some North American countries has now stabilized, and it has declined in some parts also. Plant-based meat is still at an early stage of adoption in India, but an increasing number of people are willing to try such smart proteins as they adopt more climate-conscious habits or pursue a lifestyle more in line with what they consider to be ethical. Now, before we delve into the business side of things, let us understand what plant-based meats are made of. Local markets in India are now flooded with eateries selling soya chaat masala. Have you tried one? They are spicy and taste close to kebabs. So the term plant-based meat refers to foods that mimic meat products, especially meat-like texture, but are made from plants. Some of these products are suitable for vegans, while others may contain non-vegan ingredients like egg and milk. And how is this industry faring in India? According to Research and Markets, India's meat substitutes market is expected to reach $47.57 million by 2026, with an average annual growth rate of 7.5% during 2021-2026. Clearly, the industry is still in its nascent stage in India, but with a rise in awareness, it has a bright future ahead. It has a strong case to present. Imagine a juicy burger that involves no cruelty to animals and saves us from climate change at the same time.
That's all we have for you today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news and analysis in our next episode. Stay tuned. Thank you for watching.
If you like this video, share it and subscribe to Business Standard. For more news, views and insights, log on to www.business-standard.com. Do also follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Telegram and LinkedIn.